guys hear me okay? Hi, for those of you who do not know me, I'm Danielle Surup, and I've been a parishioner here at St. Mary for about 5 years, almost 5 years, and so it's my honor to come and just share a little bit with you about my life and my sin. It's a little intimidating knowing that Father Armando is the one who's going to be coming up after me. So anyway, I will try to be brief, and I will not be answering questions. So I'm just going to jump right in. I think we all know that the topic tonight is on anger and forgiveness. And if you know me, you know that like I tend to be a pretty aggressively angry person. Not so much, but there have been times in my life, and one specific time that I'm going to share with you about tonight is a time maybe several years ago when I was just going through a really hard time in so many aspects. Financially, I was struggling. I was struggling with some things at home with my family, experiencing some loss of loved ones. I think I just lost my job, and I just kind of was finding myself in like a really desolate period of my life, and I was really struggling and really starting to feel a need for some love and attention and maybe some pity. And you know, like something that maybe you should know about me is I can be a little bit sensitive, and I don't know if that's just a woman thing or just a me thing, but you know, I get a little bit sensitive sometimes, and so I think I was really dwelling in that sensitivity. And a dear friend of mine at the time, you know, one of my best friends is still one of my best friends, and I found myself getting really angry at her, or angry with her, and like with things she was doing or not doing, and I didn't really understand why. And then I was kind of realizing, I was like, well, she's just not being a good friend, because you know, like, I'm obviously going through such a hard time, and she hasn't asked me how I'm doing, she hasn't cooked me dinner, she hasn't, you know, just shown me the love and attention that I thought maybe she should be showing me. And so this went on for maybe, you know, a few weeks where I was just, like, growing in my anger toward her, and I really didn't want to be, but I couldn't really help it. I was just becoming really irritable, especially when I came to her. I didn't want to be around her. And so I just found myself being like, this has got to stop. Either I need to say something or I need to figure this out. And I was researching something for a class I was teaching to children, and it was on humility. And so I know humility is not necessarily one of the virtues, but I think it goes hand in hand with being able to forgive. So I was looking up this thing on humility, and I came across this website, and I'm just like, okay, you know, again, thinking that I'm just researching for this class I was teaching, and there was this really kind of profound article. I don't even know if it was an article, but that really spoke to me, you know. It caught me off guard. It was kind of intense, and it was kind of brutal. And basically what it said is nobody owes you anything, not even God. And I was like, but what about, you know, like all these things, trying to justify it or prove it wrong. And then I was like, how legitimate is this Catholic website? You know, they say they're Catholic, but this can't be true. So I found myself really, again, questioning it, but also being struck by it, and I just kept coming back to it, and then I just started crying, and I was like, okay, Lord, obviously you're trying to move something in me, and, you know, what is it, Lord, that you are trying to show me about myself here, because clearly this is hitting home, and so again, it was just over and over again, like, nobody owes you anything. Not even God. And I think we tend to so many times think that, like, we're a good person, so we deserve A, B, and C. You know, like, if I have been faithful, God should give me this, that, and the other. Anyway, so I was just kind of reading on, and it was teaching me a lot about humility. And I think that was the first step toward me being able to forgive to forgive my friend and to realize, you know, like I might think that she owes me this attention because I'm going through a difficult time. And, you know, like I'm a beloved daughter of God. And so, of course, God wants those things for me. But I think during that time, he also wanted me to be able to see that, you know, to turn to him first, and that it doesn't make sense for us to rely on other people for our happiness. And so it honestly, I don't know what it was, but just realizing that, like, no matter someone else's actions, I can choose within myself to forgive and to love other people, you know, not because it's something that they have earned from me, but how does God love me? And so so just kind of reflecting on that. And I think that's what God was showing me in that moment was, you know, this is how I've loved you, and this is how I'm asking you to love others, you know, like, that they don't have to earn it. And I'm not even kidding you, like, it was like a flip or a switch flipped, and I was able to just release all the anger and to forgive my friend, to forgive God, and to forgive myself for being so petty about it all. So, again, I think, you know, like, I just encourage you guys, humility. Humility is so, so foundational in virtue, but especially, I think, in being able to forgive and to love and show mercy to another person. So, so I think with that, we'll invite Father Armando up to really educate us.
We are going to talk about a hard topic. So I say that nobody gets angry. I use the black with the, no, the whiteboard. Whiteboard for expressing the idea so I don't run too much. And we can get the essence of what I'm trying to explain here. I'm not going to use this, could be close to it, but you need it for that? Okay. I will use it better for those who are far. So, what is anger? First of all, it's an emotion. It's an emotion that every animal has, no? The bird, when they are going to have some other animal is coming to the nest, and there the brood is there, he needs some anger for defending itself. If he has an anger, he will not defend even the little birds, the babies. And I saw a picture, a movie, maybe you have seen it, of the penguins. It's amazing how there is a moment that a bird is coming for eating picking the penguin, the little penguin, and the penguins are not doing nothing. They don't have that reaction of defending. They are so, I don't know how to call it, but it's an instinct. It's a way of reacting before some kind of evil. There are many kinds of evil, but that is what we have to understand. It's a reaction before evil, an evil that they are doing to me. Here, difficulty is that, according to the classic, is the desire, that is anger, of revenge. Here are the majority of our angers, but I'm going to explain that it's more spread and bigger than this. It's a desire of revenge. When somebody has done me something wrong, that is an injury to me, and especially the closer is the person to me, the more is the anger. That is obvious. If a person on the street does something, but if my husband does it, I get very upset, or my wife, no? Why? Because depends on the kind of relationship that I am having with the people, because the injury is greater. So first thing, and very important, We don't get angry with good things. We get angry when they do something wrong. But some people get angry. They don't need nothing. I mean, they get angry because the weather is not according to what they want. So here is a bigger problem, that is our lack of acceptance of reality. That is not a revenge, it's something that is in the tantrums of the little children. When the things are not according to my will, I get angry. That is a lot of people in this world that get there. Why? Because the traffic is slow. Because this guy is driving in a way that I don't like. Because the line of confession is too long and the priest taking too much time with the people that are in the line of confession. I mean, we get angry even without injuries. Only because I have my will and I want it to be accomplished. Whatever and however, I want to be accomplished, and so I get upset. And that happened from childhood. So the best thing that a father and a mother can do with a little child is teaching them this, I was talking about humility. Because here is not forgiveness, it's nothing happening, it's that the things are not according to what you want. It's a kind of rebellion against reality. It's a kind of rebellion against God that is in every human heart. And that is the neurotic behavior in the bottom is this. Why the things are as they are and not as I want? That happens a lot to many people in many places, in a lot of circumstances, in a lot of situations. So we have to make first a big improvement that is accepting reality. I mean, here is how we resolve the problem. He is not talking about anger, because I need some days for being talking about all the questions that are connected with anger. Here the point is that we understand some steps for conquering our own anger. And the first thing is understanding that I cannot change reality. So you get upset with the circumstances, with the situations, with the things that are outside, you have to work that in little things. Because today my wife has pressed the toothpaste, you say, in another place that is not the correct place. And I get upset with that. As you can understand, it is not in its place. It has to be here and it's there. I mean, these things are a kind of continual anger. A kind of a person who is always angry. And that is, we have to avoid that kind of anger. How? Making little steps for conquering myself there and accepting reality. Accepting reality is accepting God. You refuse reality, you refuse God. It's the same thing. Because God is the author of reality. That is a first statement that is very important for learning to control the little things. Maybe you get upset also with God. Because Parish is saying, God is the author of reality, now I get upset with God instead of with the reality. Maybe we are such. But, I mean, for a Christian person, it's a good thing knowing that everything is coming from God. And it's a big step in our life, getting this. I am not the author of reality. I am not the one who controls reality. I am not the one who controls the others. I am the one who has to control myself. All virtues have a root that is self-control, or possessing myself. If I don't possess myself, I cannot have any virtue. And I have to learn these two little steps, because if I am faithful in the little things, I will be faithful in the great things. But first thing is being faithful in very little things. In the things of your life, when you complain, stop complaining, because that kind of anger with reality. When you complain, you stop complaining. Instead of complaining, give thanks to God, because he's given you a little cross. So try to make little steps for controlling the bad situations, because you are going to have a lot of moments in your life that are really bad. And you can get upset, or very upset, or in wrath, or in fury, you let the things go on. But if I learn to control the little things, who is faithful in the little will be faithful in the great things. I think that is a principle for all virtues. And this one, because we are constantly in situations that we don't like. Constantly. So if I don't learn to accept reality, Because when I read St. Thomas Aquinas, he's not talking about this. He's talking about only this, desire of revenge, because there has been an injury. So somebody has offended me, and that is a desire of revenge. But there, what I see is in this society there are thousands and millions of people who get upset for everything. So situations, circumstances that I am doing something that is not working as I want it to work, the computer is getting slower than I want, right? That is not somebody's doing you an injury. That is only that the reality is not adapting to your will. And you have to understand that is very important. You cannot adapt the reality to your will. And that is the first thing you have to teach your child. Eh? Why? Don't get tantrums. Why? Because you have to accept reality. Because if you don't accept reality, you are going to be upset all along your life. Why? Because the reality will never surrender to you. It's clear. You can kick the rock, but you are going to break your feet. I mean, how many times you kick the rock is your problem, because the rock continues to be a strong rock, and you are not doing nothing. You are harming yourself. So anger has this dimension of a reaction that, according to Thomas Aquinas and the Fathers of the Church, when it is a core, I am not going this way, because it makes too long. I explain it shortly. Anger, when it is under reason, this kind of anger is good. When it is surrendered to reason, so, because if not, I will not look for justice. I will not defend my children when somebody attacks them. I will not go in a fight for defending a person if I have done, and I will change the world, better saying courage than anger. But the classics talk about this anger in the seven capital sins. I am not going to talk about the what we would say good anger, that is looking for what? For justice.
That's a reaction to evil.
Sorry?
That's really more from the reaction to evil as opposed to...
Yes, so the reaction is because they are talking about an injury that other person does to me. And when the injury is real, for example, a person has stolen my house and has taken away all my jewelry, and I am passive and I don't do nothing. No, I get some anger for looking for the police and asking to the things be returned, and that guy go to prison because need to be in prison for a while for understanding that you cannot go in the house of other person and study that person. But that is a kind of anger that is according to reason. So every movement, that is a very general understanding of things, but it's very important. It's very important. Every movement of the affectivity, of the emotional level, of feelings, when it is under reason, is not bad. That is called virtues. A virtue is when the affectivity, the emotional level, the level of feelings is surrendered to reason. And that are all virtues. But when the affectivity, the emotional level, bursts, in this case, is never a virtue. It's against virtues. So, and I'm going to go to the seven daughters of anger. Have a lot of daughters. The first are in the head or in the mind or inside, we will say. The first is indignation. When somebody does me evil, and I get indignated, and I get annoyed. So it's something that happens as a reaction that is, if it is growing, can be horrible. But this is the first, is inside us, is indignation. If I begin to brood, and to think, and to ponder, and to reflect how I revenge on the other person, in that case, I go to a situation that is not only indignation, it's a desire of revenge, and of the anger becomes fury. Fury, like this?
Yes.
Or wrath. But it's inside, yes. So you, how many times you or me have been thinking and thinking and brooding something and getting torn and again with the same thing and stopping? That creates a lot of problems. This is an anger is, in this case, is an acid that or a poison that the greatest harm is making it to the person who is having it. And that is the greatest reason for not being with anger, because the greatest harm are doing it to yourself. So it's another reason why, because I will give some steps for trying to stop the anger. It's not easy, I mean, because everyone has a point of boiling. And so you put the, depending on what they are doing you, you boiled, or people are with their, they are more cool and more distant, and they don't get so quickly, and other people are quickly to get upset and angry, and it's depending on the temper. But everyone has to learn to control his own anger. I have a lot of anger. But I control it. For me. I have learned to control it. I mean, because anger, in some way, when it's, it gives you courage. So you are able to face the problems sometimes, but if you control it according to your reason, and in that case, it's a great power that you have for doing things. Because it's the way you face evil. It's the face you wear, you face the problems. You face the difficulties. Is your power there for facing the problems? What? The anger, because there are reactions before evil. You don't react with anger before good. No, that you react with desire. Anger is the reaction before evil. And so, I have them here written. So the first is, because this desire of revenge generates in the person these things. First, inside, that are in the mind of the heart, magnifying the injury. That is indignation. When you begin to think about the thing that they have done to you, and you get there, the other is keeping things for a long time and going and again and again over the same thing. There are people who, I mean, they are sick of anger. And you see in their faces, it's a consequence of this keeping things that happened long time ago. And they continue coming again and again to the same things. There are a lot of people in this society because we are in situations that are relationships. Sometimes people, I am a priest, and I know how many people have problems that they are keeping from childhood. And they never free themselves from the problem of childhood. Why? Because they continue brooding then and thinking and turning again and again about the same problems. I mean, that is not good. That is a kind of creating inside you a mood that is destroying your relationship, because anger has a lot of consequences. Opening to anger is opening to a lot of sins, not only the sin of anger. There are a lot of sins that come with anger. So controlling it is controlling a lot of things, not letting them to come inside me. So in the mind and the heart, this the St. Thomas Aquinas call it, when you are going and engaged, inflated ego, and create rancor, fury, wrath, aggressivity. So it's an increase of this, because I am looking in ways of revenge. And I am pondering them. And I continue harming myself, because sometimes even don't come out from your heart. And you keep there. I mean, it's a horrible thing doing that inside you. Second is when it's in the mouth. The shouting is also insulting. It's more great. Your shouting can be saying the things, but not saying something aggressive to the other person. He's saying the things in a very loud voice because you are upset and angry. But there is another level that is insulting the other person. And there is also against God, in this case, can become blasphemy. into God. I mean, it's a big thing in that case. But become something that is now out. And the third dimension is when anger become in works. And that is quarrel. Quarrel that can mean to a lot of things. Is strife, fights, wounding the other person, or even murder. So anger can finish in a lot of behavior that are horrible. We don't go there majority of times, but in the bottom, the revenge is without measure, without reason. And that is what is the anger that is bad. I mean, I see when I want to restore a situation of injustice that I need some anger for moving there. But it's more courage. I will change the word because I think it's more clear to express that. Facing a situation of evil for restoring justice. It's more courage than anger. So I'm not there. The problem with anger is that we can get upset and angry with my wife and with my husband, with my children, with my co-workers. And usually these are the greatest moments of anger. I mean, because with the people outside, maybe I'm going in the car and I get a moment of upset, I bring my finger out and I continue driving and I forget that. But with my wife and my husband, is I am seeing him or her all along the day. And so, if I don't heal my heart, it's reminding me what happened before. And so, are people, this is not a very good thing, but people who remind the injuries after 1 year, 3 years, 4 years, 20 years, 30 years to their spouse. That is not good, as you can understand. That is a way of harming the situation, the relationship, and saying, here is no healing. Here is no future. And that is because of the anger of what the other person has done to you. When this travel is not moving, I move. So, anger has a contrary virtue. It's meekness. Meekness is the virtue that Jesus recommended. Anger is when meekness is when somebody does me something wrong, and instead of acting with evil to that person, so turning him some evil, I turn that person good. It's so difficult. That even more difficult than humility. No? Amen. But that is what Jesus is inviting to us. Learn from me that I am humble and meek of heart. And he gives us a witness in his passion. The priests and those who are reading the Divine Office during these days of Lent, we are praying this prayer in the morning every day. Come, let us adore Christ, the Lord who for our sake endured temptation and suffering. And you know what is his temptation and suffering? Insults, blows, spitting him, scorching him, nailing him. And look how he reacted. Where is his anger? So, contemplating Jesus is the greatest way of conquering of anger and wanting to be as him. And the reason of meditating, for also preparing, because during the day are going to happen things that are against your will. Are happening things in your marriage. Are going to happen things with your children. But if you are not prepared for facing them, I mean, you're going to get upset and angry because you are not preparing your heart. One of the first things is preparing my heart for the things that are coming, accepting them. Why? Because if you accept them, you don't let anger come in. And so all these things that are coming, because you know, indignation is when I increase the injury, because sometimes a person has done something wrong. And I get upset because he has not cleaned the glass that he was using for breakfast. I mean, how can you get upset for that? I mean, but people get upset for these things because it's my wife who is doing that, or better, it's my husband who is doing that. And frequently and every day, he's not cleaning whatever. And I get upset because he's not cleaning whatever. I mean, it's not very, very healthy, no? So the thing here is having the disposition first of understanding, and that is what we have to teach our children from childhood. Very little, 2 years, when the tantrums are there. Never, my little baby, never reality will surrender to your will. Because it's that, it's the chalice. You know, they talk in when they are talking about the psychology of children, it's like they think that they are omnipotent, that they can do everything. That is what they think. And the reason they sometimes they won't do things because they cannot do anything, everything. But it's also in their will. It's that kind of the things have to be what I want. And we have to teach that the children, that the people who are with big problems of anger management, is because when they were little, their parents has not correct them there in their anger. They have let the tantrums go on and say okay, and let the child to continue with his her tantrum. And that grows when they grow, because every day there are things that are not according to your will. So here is the in which we are going to concentrate now. I insist that there is all a whole level of anger that is because reality is not according to what I will. Eh? Because the circumstances are not what I want, and because the situation is not what I want, or because I am not doing the things so well as I want. That is an anger that we have to meditate and work it, because that has no justification. I mean, it's your pride only there. It's my pride, because the things are not what I want. The things are not never as you want. Never is never. I mean, you have to surrender to reality every day, that is surrender to God at the same time. So, getting here, I am going to here to the root of this sin also, because it's the root of all the capital sin and deadly sins. It's the desire of being loved, appreciated, honored, wanted, liked, esteemed. I can continue, the list is so long. And that desire is ruling your heart. From that desire are coming the seven capital sins. Because that desire is selfishness itself. So you are not able to face this desire, you cannot conquer almost any capital sin. Lust is coming from this, pride is connected with it, and it's coming also from it, because the desire of being loved is the rule of all the other desires, and the root of everything. Because that is selfishness of disorder, self-love. It's that desire, it's a desire, it's not a thinking, it's not that you are thinking, no. It's that you are doing everything for being loved. And when the people don't treat you according to the idea you have for yourself, and you think that you have to be esteemed and wanted and loved, in that moment, one of the reactions is anger. Because the other person is not treating you according to your dignity, your value, and your desire of being esteemed, honored. The stronger is the desire, the greater is the anger. No? Obviously. So more desire I want of being appreciated and wanted, when a person does something against my dignity, against what I think that I, as what they were saying before, I mean, as I think that they have a debt with me, they own something to me, I mean, but is there? More I think that, more I get upset. So how facing these things? That is a huge thing. First thing, when this desire, the only way you can conquer it is called prayer life and Christian life. It's opening it to God. Because you cannot control this desire. This desire is ruling your behavior at the behavior of all humanity. The only way of conquering it is putting it in God and being a child of God, living from the love of God. If we don't do that, it's very difficult, everything. Because now it's my effort. And here it's not about your effort in Christian life. I mean, it's about how I am opening my desires to the one who can fulfill them, that is my God and my Father. Because this desire is the desire that was your relationship with your parents when you were little. And that desire sometimes is very bad fulfilled by our parents, because they have their own problems, and they have their own lacks, and they have their own pride and vanity and anger, and they have the lot of things that they have our parents. So they cannot fulfill this desire. It's impossible. And when we grow, we detach from our parents this desire, and we put it in the world, trying to be loved by the world. And that is ruling our behavior. The only way of conquering it is opening it to the one who has created us for living from his love. And that is the reason of prayer life. We need to pray for opening to the love of God, so my desire of being loved be quenched. That was what Jesus was saying to the Samaritan woman 2 weeks ago. No, or it was this weekend, not the other weekend. Who was saying about that? What? I mean, a woman that was desiring to be loved and has been with 5 men and now was with a man that was not her husband. And so the situation was so horrible that she was going at that time to get the water for not meeting with anyone, because that was not the time of getting the water 12 in the morning. I mean, she was going alone so the other women on the town don't see her. Why? Because the shame of her situation. But it's because the desire of being loved, from there is coming all the other things. So the first thing for conquering our desires is putting this desire in God. What? The desire of being loved. That is prayer life, that is spiritual life, and this is the process of growing in and maturing in spiritual life. More love a person will receive from God, less desires of the pride, vanity, jealousy, envy, criticizing, judging, and all these things that all then are coming from this desire. And it's working it, but you have to work it. If you don't open this desire to God, this desire is ruling your behavior, it's ruling my behavior, it's ruling every human behavior. The worry that you have with your body is the desire of being loved. The worry that you have eating that or not eating that is the desire of being loved. All the advertisement and all the things that you see in TV is the desire of being loved. So it's always ruling our behavior. Why? Because we want to be loved. But the point that we put in the wrong place the desire. So try to open it to God. And in anger, you have here 3 steps that you can talk about them, because I think I am going to finish, so you can have your talks. So I give you 3 steps that are from St. Francis of Sales. Remedies against anger. First, reject it immediately. So don't let it come inside you. Whatever is happening, by distracting your mind and not saying a word. So don't make it this, that is letting it to grow inside you. I mean, reject it, do something else. Go to walk, listen music, do something. So don't let the anger to get inside you, because when anger gets inside a person, it's very difficult to get it out. It's very, very difficult. So the first thing and the great battle is not letting it to come inside me. What somebody's doing something wrong to me, okay, I go and I begin to think other things. But if you go in that moment and let the anger come, I mean, the quarrel is coming and maybe other things that are worse, insulting or faulting or lacking of respect to the other person. Right? Because anger destroys the mind. So that is what is this second thing, that is fury and wrath. Don't let the person think. And those things that for a moment of rage, you're going to be repenting all along your life. I mean, especially with the words. I mean, when you insult a person, you know, there's a, I also don't know if you say in English, wrinkled paper, when you're arrugado, yeah. Wrinkled. Wrinkled. No? Yeah. So what happened when you insult another person? You do this. And now, when you try to ask for forgiveness, you try to correct the thing. But what happened? Even you try very hardly, the marks are here. And you have created some marks in the heart of other person. And that is painful for many people, that keep this feeling down because other person is insulting. And it's one of the things. There is a beautiful expression, because you know, contrary to anger, there are 3 things. Meekness is the first, is the virtue, but it's also forgiveness. And it's patience. These are the three virtues that can and must work anger. Forgiveness is very important because we are going to get upset and angry some days. It's part of human life. So now I have to quickly to become forgiveness as God is forgiving me. Pretending that I am looking for something for God and asking God for something that I don't want to give to the others is mocking God. I mean, if I ask God for forgiveness to me and I don't forgive the others, I am mocking God. That's an expression of one of the fathers of the church. I mean, why? I mean, you want to be forgiven and you don't forgive? I mean, what kind of relationship, you know, is in the Our Father? So forgiveness is essential. There was two guys who were very good friends and they were in the desert and they have only one bottle of water, and one of them fell and the water
spilled out
and they lost the water, and the other get angry and upset with him and get him almost killing him. And then he stopped and they continue working and upset. And now they come to Oasis, so the place where they get to Oasis, and there they began to drink water, but the one who spilled out the water fell in the water and he don't know how to swim. And the friend throw them to the water and take him out, I mean, and with an effort and put him out. And after that, he began to write in the rock, "Today, my friend has saved me my life." And because before, he wrote something in the sand. "What do you wrote in the sand before when I was almost killing you?" He said, "I wrote in the sand, 'Today my friend was trying to kill me.'" And said, "Well, you wrote that in the sand and now you wrote this in rock." Because the good things that a friend does to you, you have to write them in rock and never forget them. And the bad things that a friend does to you, you have to write them in the sand and with the wind erase them and you forget them. I mean, in marriage is very important. In your marriage, you are going to have problems every day of your life. Well, not every day, maybe some days not. If you don't have a heart that is in the disposition of forgiving, you are going to have problems all along your marriage. And forgiving every day, because she, as he, is weak. It's with a lot of shortcomings. It's with a lot of failures. It's a lot of problems in his heart. And he is going to do the things wrong, yes. But if you don't have that disposition of forgiveness, I mean, marriage become a place where resentment and a desire of revenge keep in the heart of other person. That is horrible. I mean, it's a way of destroying everything. So first step, I finish with these three things that Francis observes. First thing is reject it immediately by distracting your mind and not saying a word to the other person, of course, and not pondering it in your head. Imitate the apostles when they saw the storm of the Sea of Galilee. Turn to God, who brings peace to the heart. Turn to God. I mean, if you do that, you know this is real. There were two priests that were very good friends, and one make a bad joke to the other, and there's some things in the table that he was working on then, and he gets so upset, the priest, and so angry, that was going to the room of the other priest, they were in the seminary, and was going to the room of the other priest with all the wrath for insulting him, and it was necessary to fight with him, and when he was on the way, he met with the spiritual director of the seminary. I said, "The spiritual director saw me." I said, "Wow, where is this guy going?" But, "What happened? What happened? What is happening?" "Hey, you don't know what he has done to me. He is a beep, beep." I say, okay, I understand what happened. And you have the reason. But you are going to his room, so you pass through the chapel. Why you don't stop there for a moment and pray a moment?" "No! Because if I go to the chapel, I have to forgive him, and I don't want to forgive him." So, when wrath is coming to your heart, turn to God. It's the best way. I mean, it's impossible that you are in wrath and you put yourself before God. It's impossible. It's not difficult, it's impossible. So work it. And third, If you see that because of your weakness, anger has already gotten a foothold in your spirit, force yourself to calm down and then try to act humbly and gently toward the person with whom you are irritated. But all this must be done with delicacy and without violence, for it is very important not to rub salt into the wounds. So, when you have been wounded, I mean, don't move the thing. Try to escape from the situation. It's very important. Anger is something that is part of our lives, is connected with, but looking to Jesus, we learn our virtues. Looking to Jesus, we learn our virtues. And meditating his passion is the best way of learning meekness, patience, and forgiveness. Because what he has done for you, and what we have done to him, and instead what they are doing to us, and how we react, I mean, it's a huge difference. So looking there and meditating the passion of Jesus and his love for us, and his meekness, you know, the passion of Jesus is the teaching of all the virtues that we need for loving each other. Yeah. Love is not irritated. It's one of the expressions of St. Paul he talked about charity. We ask Mary to give us that patience and that meekness, that forgiveness, and that humility that are the source of every virtue. And she was there on the cross when they crucified her son, and she was not upset or angry. And the injustice was huge. But he was loving because she was in God and she was with God, and she was putting all his desire only one thing, in God. I mean, our desires make us worse or good, and that is what we have to try to change. We ask her to give us in this time of Lent that we are preparing for the living the passion of her son, and to give us understanding how powerful is a person who is meek, who is humble, and who is forgiving the others. Because that is a lot of power in your family, with your children, with your wife, and with your husband. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. And knowing that we are temples of God, and it's good that the temple of God be calm and still and silence, we give glory to our Father. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.